This is the second part of our lecture. We will discuss the leveling and overbite control. I will talk about the two movement of bite opening, then leveling and overbite control, and finally what will we do in non-extraction treatment versus extraction treatment. Arch leveling and overbite control. Overbite control is more closely related to the arch leveling process, and that is generally occurs after the leveling and alignment of individual teeth. For example, many cases show well aligned teeth in the early part of treatment, but still have a significant amount of deep overbite with arches that are not leveled. Development of deep overbite. Anterior teeth continue to erupt until contact is made with opposing anterior teeth or the soft tissue of palate, or until the tongue inhibits their eruption. Later, unrestricted eruption of lower second permanent molar contribute to development of posterior part of curve of SP in class 2 cases. The tooth movement of bite opening, eruption or extrusion of posterior teeth, distal tipping of posterior teeth, proclination of incisors, intrusion of incisors, or a combination of two or more of the above tooth movement. Eruption or extrusion of posterior teeth. The eruption of posterior teeth is a normal vertical molar relationship in a growing individual. It is a stable process that accompanies vertical facial development. The normal eruption of posterior teeth is a contributing factor in achieving bite opening in deep bite patients. In growing patients, the increase in vertical facial height accommodates the extrusion of posterior teeth that can occur during orthodontic treatment, while leveling of the curve of SP and using intermaxillary elastics. In adults with average to low mandibular plane angle, it is another stable process. The musculature generally resists this extrusion, and by the end of treatment or shortly after, the molar return to their original vertical position. While in high-angle adult patient with weaker musculature, orthodontic extrusion of posterior teeth may remain stable as the end of treatment with permanent opening of mandibular plane. This is undesirable in most high-angle cases. Distal tipping of posterior teeth. In growing patient, this is normally a stable process in the growing patient, as it is accommodated by the increase in vertical facial height. While in adult with average to low mandibular plane angle, it is not stable because it will followed by intrusion of these teeth to the original vertical dimension. This may not occur during orthodontic treatment, but will normally follow shortly after and can be a source of post-orthodontic relapse of deep bite. In high-angle adult patient, the distal tipping of posterior teeth may lead to some permanent opening of mandibular plane and is to be avoided. Sometimes, the equilibration of posterior teeth after distal tipping is beneficial in these high-angle adult case. Proclination of incisors. Proclination of incisors lead to bite opening in anterior area. In the lower arch, this generally consists of lower incisor crowns being proclined. In the upper arch, a combination of crown proclination and root torque control normally occur, with root moving distally. Intrusion of anterior teeth. In growing patient, intrusion of anterior teeth is normally not required, as the face grow vertically, preventing or even restricting the normal eruption of these anterior teeth will essentially allow the bite to grow or open as posterior eruption, extrusion, and or distal tipping occur. While in adult, where the musculature resists these posterior change, Therefore, bite opening in adult must be brought about by the proclination of incisors and or intrusion of these teeth. The intrusion of anterior teeth in this adult case can be brought about with full arch treatment, but the process occurs slowly. Therefore, the use of supplemental intrusion arches as advocated by Ricketts or Barrystone may assist the incisor intrusion process which is required for this adult patient. The second part of our lecture, we will talk about leveling by extrusion and leveling by intrusion. Leveling by extrusion is called relative intrusion, and this is preferable in younger patients. While leveling by intrusion is called absolute intrusion, and this is preferable in older patients. Leveling by extrusion accomplished with continuous arch wire simply by placing an exaggerated curve of SB in maxillary arch wire and a reverse curve of SB in mandibular arch wire. It is necessary to replace the initial highly resilient alignment arch with a slightly stiffer one to complete the leveling. The choice of wire for this purpose is affected by whether the 18 or 22 slot edgewise appliance is being used. 18 slot narrow brackets. When preliminary alignment is completed, the second arch wire is almost 16 steel with exaggerated curve of SB in upper arch and reverse curve in lower arch. This is sufficient to complete the leveling. In some patients, especially in non-extraction treatment of older patients who have little of any remaining cross, an arch wire heavier than 16 steel is needed to complete the leveling of the arch. This is curved arch for the upper dental arch, and this is for the lower arch. This picture shows the effect of reverse curve in the lower arch. If you will use an arch wire heavier than 16 milli steel, use 18 milli arch wire and then add auxiliary leveling arch of 17 multiply 25 milli TMA or steel. Although the auxiliary leveling arch look like an intrusion arch, it differ in two ways. First, the presence of a continuous rather than segmented base arch. Second, the higher amount of force. This picture shows auxiliary leveling wire prior to and after activation. By tying it beneath a continuous mandibular arch wire, the appropriate force in this instance is approximately 150 g, and the expected action is leveling by extruding the premolar rather than intruding the incisors. For absolute intrusion, light force, approximately 10 g per tooth, is necessary. This requires use of arch wire segment and an auxiliary intrusion arch. For absolute intrusion, light force, approximately 10 g per tooth, is necessary. This requires the use of arch wire segment and an auxiliary intrusion arch. This picture, intrusion arch prior to and after activation. By bending it downward and tying it to the segment to be intruded, the force delivered by the intrusion arch can be measured easily when it is brought down to the level at which it will. It is sometimes said that the wire available for use with the 18 slot appliance are not large enough to accomplish all necessary tooth movement. One of the few situations in which that may be true is in leveling with continuous arch wire. Occasionally, 20 millisteel wire with a reverse curve is required to complete the leveling in a patient with 22 slot brackets. The 18 slot equivalent is an auxiliary wire as exaggerated above. When we use 22 slot wider bracket, initial alignment with knot tie wire is usually followed by 16 millisteel wire with a reverse or accentuated curve and then by 18 milli round wire to complete the leveling. This arch wire sequence is nearly always adequate for completion of leveling, and it is unusual that 20 milli wire or an auxiliary arch wire is required. With either slot size, it is an error to place a rectangular arch wire with exaggerated curve of SB in the medullary arch because the curve carries torque to move the incisor root laterally. This is undesirable, so the arch should be level before a rectangular wire is placed, or a step bends rather than a reverse curve of SB should be placed in rectangular wire. While in maxillary arch, however, a rectangular wire with accentuated curve of SB would be acceptable if lingual root torque of upper incisor was needed. Leveling by intrusion require mechanical arrangement other than a continuous arch wire attached to each tooth. The key to success intrusion is light continuous force directed toward the tooth apex. It is necessary to avoid pitting intrusion of one tooth against the extrusion of its neighbor, since in that circumstance extrusion will dominate. This can be accomplished in two ways. First way, with continuous arch wire that bypass the premolar and frequently the canine teeth. Secondly, with segmented arch wire so that there is no connection along the arch between the anterior and posterior segment and an auxiliary depression arch. Bypass arches are most useful for patients who will have some cross. Its action, uprighting, distal tapping of molar, and intrusion of incisor. The method of bypass, two method, first method, 2x4 appliance, only 2 molars and 4 incisors. Second method, Ricketts utility arch. This is a 2x4 appliance. It creates light force necessary for incisor intrusion and it makes it possible to create unwanted side effect. A transpalatal lingual arch for additional anchorage is a good idea. This is a diagrammatic representation of the force for a leveling arch that bypass the premolar with anchor bend mesial to the molar. A force system is created that elongates the molars and intrudes the incisors. The wire tends to slide posteriorly through the molar tube, tapping the incisor distally at expense of bodily mesial movement of molars. An arch wire of this design is used in first stage of PEG treatment, but also can be used in HY system. A long span from the molar to the incisor is essential. Successful use of any type of bypass arch for leveling requires that the force be kept light. This is accomplished by two ways. First, selecting a small diameter arch wire. Second, using a long span between first molar and incisors. Wire heavier than 16 millisteel shouldn't be used, and Ricketts recommended soft 16 multiply by 16 cobalt chromium wire for utility arch. A more modern recommendation would be 16 multiply by 22 beta nitride wire. Whatever the wire choice, overactivation of the vertical band can cause loss of control of motor in all three plans of his baby. Two weakness of bypass arch system limits the amount of true intrusion that can be obtained. Only the first molar is available as posterior anchorage. This means that significant extrusion of the tooth may occur. In actively growing patient with a good facial pattern, this is not a major problem, but in non-growing patient or those with a poor facial pattern in whom molar extrusion should be avoided, the lack of posterior anchorage compromises the ability to intrude incisor. The second weakness is that the intrusive force against the incisor is applied anterior to the center of resistance. With extraction space, forward movement of incisor is an inevitable consequence of leveling. While in extraction cases, when the incisor are to be retracted, this become undesirable side effect. Intrusion arch tied in midline, as only the central incisor are intruded, so that the incisor will tip facially as they intrude. In the same patient later, an intrusion arch now is tied between the central and the lateral incisor to intrude all four incisors while reducing the amount of facial tipping. Segmented arch. The segmented arch approach allow attachment on all the teeth and so provide better control of anchorage. For intrusion of anterior teeth, it depends on establishing stabilized posterior segment and controlling the point of force application against an anterior segment. After initial alignment, a full dimension rectangular arch wire is placed in bracket slot. In addition, a heavy lingual arch is used to connect the right and the left posterior segment, further stabilizing them against undesired movement. For intrusion, an auxiliary arch placed in auxiliary tube on first molar is used to apply intrusive force against the anterior segment. This picture show performed upper and lower Connecticut intrusion arch made from nickel titanium alloy. The biomechanical design for lower incisor intrusion with CTA. Now we will discuss the non-extraction treatment. Non-extraction treatment generally favor bite opening. This is because distal tipping of posterior teeth and proclination of incisors normally occur in this case. There are a number of mechanical factors that lead to arch leveling and control of deep overbite. First, initial arch wire placement. When flat arch wire are placed into dental arches with curve of SB, the arch wire attempt to return to their original shape and this starts the bite opening process. 2. The bite plate effect. It allows for early placement of brackets on lower incisor. It also produces intrusive force on lower incisor, which limits any further extrusion of these teeth. Finally, it allows for eruption, extrusion, and or uprighting of posterior teeth. we have two type of bite plate, posterior bite plate or anterior bite plate. Posterior bite plate can be done by two ways. First way, by acrylic bite plate. Second way, by using colored adhesive on occlusal force on the first molar. We prefer the posterior bite plane in average to high angle case, while anterior bite plane preferred in low angle case. It may incorporated in acrylic removable appliance, or this is a bite ramp used on the palatal surface of anterior teeth. The importance of second molar. In average to low angle deep bite cases, the earliest possible bending or bonding of second molar, especially the lower second molar, is most beneficial in bite opening. As this picture show, inclusion of second molar in treatment provide an excellent lever arm for eruption or extrusion of premolar and first molar, and then this assist in incisor intrusion. Torque issue. Up to 20 of palatal root torque can be introduced in the upper wire in incisor area, and 10 to 15 of labial root torque can be introduced into incisor area of lower wire. These torque change contribute to bite opening process. Bite opening curve. The author prefer not to place bite opening curve in round wire or to have such a curve built into rectangular heat activated wire. In the great majority of cases, after rectangular stainless steel wire have been in place for six weeks, the arches are normally level and adequate bite opening has been achieved. If this is not so, then bite opening curve can be placed into rectangular steel wire. Placing a bite opening curve in upper arch wire increase palatal root torque to the upper incisors. This is beneficial in majority of cases, and it is usually unnecessary to add any additional torque bend to this upper wire, but is sometimes needed. When bite opening or reverse curve is placed in lower rectangular steel wire, the result is proclination of lower incisor. Therefore, before placement of bite opening curve in lower wire, approximately 10 to 12 of labial root torque can be added. Anterior posterior issue and elastics. It is recommended that rectangular stainless steel wire should be placed in place when are used. There are beneficial in treatment of most growing patients. If possible, they should be avoided in most non-growing and adult high-angle cases. Spacing in non-extraction case. Non-extraction cases normally don't show significant amount of spacing. With the use of tieback, the spaces can be closed without difficulty. Space closure shouldn't be attempted until full bite opening and leveling has been achieved. Finally, we will talk about extraction treatment. Light force during leveling and alignment and light force during space closure must be considered. extraction treatment. Most of mechanical treatment procedure described for deep bite non-extraction cases also apply to deep bite extraction case. These include effect of arch wire deflection, tip in bracket, use of bite blade effect, bending of second molar, torquing effect of rectangular wire. There are two other important factors in extraction deep bite cases. Lower incisors are normally maintained in their position or brought to a more retroclined position. This makes the bite opening more difficult. If space closure is attempted before proper arch leveling and overbite control, it will lead to bite deepening. A light force during leveling and alignment. Extreme care must be taken not to tip cause bite distally, because this results in extrusion of incisor and further bite deepening. Roller coaster effect. Elastic forces should be avoided because they can result in excessive distal tipping of canine. This can lead to posterior bite opening, and overall reaction has been called roller coaster effect, which increases overall treatment time and complicates the case. Light force during space closure. The canines can tip into the extraction site, causing arch wire deflection and bending. The sliding mechanics then become ineffective and overbite deepen. Excessive force overpowers the incisor torque control of rectangular wire, particularly in our arch, causing distal tipping and bite deepening. A small amount of torque added to upper arch wire plus lighter force lead to effective in minimizing these two bite deepening factor. Unfavorably angled canines can cause unwanted extrusion of incisors after placement of initial arch wire. When canines are unfavorable angle, avoid bracketing the incisor until the canine root have been retracted, providing more favorable angulation of canine slot. An alternative technique involves placing a band in arch wire mesial to canine to make a slight intrusive force on incisor while the canine roots are being moved distally. Arch wire sequence. According to Prophet, this is a desirable arch wire sequence in non-extraction versus extraction treatment in 18 slot versus 22 slot. This is the end of our lecture, and thank you for your attention.